Hello there! This is part 2 of a series where we learn every single extension present in the latest Inkscape release. If you haven't already checked out part 1, link to the full playlist in the description. This time we'll take a look at the menus GcodeTools, Generate from Path, Images, JessyInk, and Modify Path. Also, don't forget to like and subscribe. I make Inkscape and illustration videos every week, and every like, subscription, and comment really helps out a lot and keeps the channel afloat. Okay, let's continue with the extensions. The GcodeTools menu has extensions related to using Gcode in Inkscape. Gcode is a standard language used for printing with a plotter or cutter. Inkscape is not made to be used with that type of printers, so you need extensions to add that extra information so your designs can be properly read. I've never used one of these printers for anything. I got no idea how to use Gcode or how these extensions relate to Gcode. I don't think I'm qualified to talk about these extensions at all, even if I'd learn how to use them, so I won't. These extensions are pretty niche anyway, so I guess it's fine if we skip the entire menu. I prefer to leave you a link to a video I checked out on Gcode and Inkscape that looked pretty good. The link will be in the description. Generate from Path has extensions that will generate new paths from existing ones, similar to the Generate and Experimental Path Effects categories. But not in real time, of course. Construct from Triangle will take the first three nodes of a path and generate different geometrical shapes based on their position. In the Common Objects tab, you have a ton of possible shapes to build. You can even select more than one option and generate more than one type of shape. Make sure to check them all. Then you have the Custom Points and Options tab. This will allow you to build a shape using math. I wasn't able to make it work, plus math is scary, so I'll just skip over it. Distribute along path is similar to the path effect pattern along path, but interestingly enough, it is a bit better, if you don't count the fact that it's not real-time, since you can actually use groups. Both objects have to be selected, and the one that will distribute the objects should be below. Follow the path orientation will make it so the object will rotate to follow the orientation of the line. Space between copies will adjust the separation. Normal offset will offset the path. Use negative numbers to offset it in the opposite direction. Rotate pattern 90 degree clockwise will do that, rotate the object. The drop-down original pattern will be handles what will happen when you apply the extension. Moved will move the original path from its position, basically deleting the original. Duplicate will leave it where it is and create duplicates. And clones will create clones, meaning that if you modify the original, it will pass all of its changes to the copies on the path. Very interesting option. Finally, if you enable the option if pattern is a group, you can spread multiple different objects along the path. With the drop-down pick group members, you can select how they are going to be selected, randomly or sequentially. All in all, a great extension to keep in mind. Extrude between two paths is like a combination between the path effect extrude and fill between many. This extension will generate a path that joins together two different paths. It uses the nodes to define where they will join, so it's best to use paths with equal amounts of nodes. In the mode dropdown, you have three options that control how the path will be generated. The line mode will just generate lines connecting each node. By default, the extension will group all the different paths, but if you enable the option combine lines to single path, will instead make a single path with no group. This option only works with the line mode. The polygon mode will create polygons based on the lines made by the nodes. And follow curves will do the same, but they will follow the curvature of the paths. This is most likely the option you want. Another useful and interesting extension to keep in mind. Frame will generate a rectangle or ellipse to match the bounding box of the selected objects, thus framing them. The most important options here are the frame dropdown, where you can choose between using a rectangle or ellipse. Then there is the treat selection as group checkbox to treat the different selected objects as a single object, creating a single frame. The stacking order dropdown will change the C order of the frame. Another useful option could be the clip selected objects to frame, which will do that. Use a clip to hide every section of the object that sticks outside of the generated frame, which can happen when you select the ellipse frame type. And of course, you have the style options, which are the exact same they show on the fill and stroke dialog. Inset Outset Halo will generate other paths that will follow the contour of the selected path. The generated path will merge and join together and have a lower opacity, making this halo effect that looks great. Width will handle how far away the offset will be. The maximum is 50. And number of steps will handle how many paths will be generated. I don't know if this is a bug or a feature of the extension, but when using the preview, every time you change some value, it will not delete the old generated paths, so watch out for that. Interpolate between paths will take two different paths and generate shapes that are the in-between, similar to the interpolate subpath effect, only that this extension uses two different paths. The most important option here is the interpolation step, which controls how many paths will be generated. Exponent will change the location of the generated path, so they'll be more to one side or the other. Interesting extension, but since you cannot use groups, interpolate subpath may be a better option. Check my path effect playlist to see how to use it. Link in the description. Long shadow will generate a path, simulating being a cast shadow. This generated shape will be most likely not a path, but a group of multiple paths. It works similarly to the extrusion extension we just saw. With the length option, you set the length. With the angle option, you set the angle in degrees. You can also enable fill shadow with the stroke color, which will do just that. Pattern along path is basically the extension version of the path effect of the same name, though this extension has a couple of extra options. It has very similar options to the path effect version. Copies of pattern will change the way the pattern is spread through the path. Most likely you'll want the option repeated. Deformation type will change the way the object deforms through the other paths. This is something new to this extension. Snake will rotate the object to match the rotation of the path, and ribbon will always place the object upright no matter the direction. Space between copies will change the spacing, and normal offset and tangential offset will change the offset. Don't forget you can use negative numbers. You can also hit pattern is vertical to flip the object. This extension does have those deformation options that are not present in the path effect, but they are not worth the sacrifice of the real-time controls in my opinion. Voronoi Diagram will generate a Voronoi Diagram, which is this, I think. In the type of diagram, you can switch between Voronoi Diagram, which will create these cells around the object, and Delineate Triangulation, which will make these points, and a combination of both. You can also show a bounding box of where the diagram is active. The Images extension menu has extensions that control how images are handled in the SVG document. Many options in these extensions are repeated in the preferences for the images. I remind you that to access the image options, you can go to Edit, Preferences, Imported Images. For the most part, you'll want to leave everything here as it is by default. Embed Images will embed the selected image into the SVG document. By default, any imported image will be embedded into the SVG document, meaning that the image will be stored inside of the SVG file. This is usually what you'll want, but you can disable that in the imported image preferences by changing Bitpath import mode to link. Link has its benefits. The SVG file will be much smaller since it no longer stores the image. But the drawback is that if you lose the image, you mess up the document. Anyway, this extension will force all of the images in the document, or in case you enable this checkbox, only the selected images to be embedded, even if you have the bitmap import mode set to link. It's a bit of a useless extension in my opinion, because going to the options and changing the mode, it takes like 5 seconds. Extract Images is a bit more useful, because it allows you to save to your hard drive the images present in the document, whether they are embedded or not. Once again, you have the option to affect only the selected images, or all the images in the document, with this checkbox. You have to set a directory. One option that can be useful is Link Extracted Images, which will set every extracted image to be linked. That is, it will remove the embed mode from that image, which is something that you may want to do after getting the images, maybe to make the document of a smaller size. Set Image Attributes will change some options regarding the way the images are displayed. Many of these options seem to be legacy, because they are not present in the imported images preferences. Plus, every option I choose here will result in the image getting this placeholder item. That's why I wouldn't recommend you to touch anything here. The default options and the ones you can change in the imported images preferences seem to do just fine, and nothing of what is shown here looks super important. The JessyInk menu has extensions that allows you to use JessyInk. JessyInk is a group of extensions that embed JavaScript inside the Inkscape SVG files in order to add some presentation software functionality, basically letting you make slides with animations, transitions, keyboard and mouse navigation, and all of that. Sadly, however, you can only see the animations and interaction when you open the SVG file in a web browser. Remember that the SVG format is designed for web, all Inkscape documents open in web browsers. Since there is not an interactive interface, there is no effective way to pre-visualize what you're doing until you export and open the document in the browser, making everything really slow and awkward to work. As it is right now, I wouldn't recommend it to use it for serious work, even if you feel more comfortable with Inkscape. Any dedicated presentation software has the same functionality and more. I think JessyInk is certainly worth a look, but maybe more as its own thing and in its own video, but not along with other extensions. In any case, let me know in the comments if that's something you will be interested on. For now, we'll skip this menu as well. I promise you this will be the last menu we'll skip. The Modify Path menu has extensions that change the geometry of a path. Add nodes will add nodes based on a specified set of segments or in a particular length. You change the mode based on division method. The first mode, by max segment length, will take the value set in the maximum segment length and will add nodes to divide the path into the number set here. It is a bit difficult to calculate how the path will be split if you don't have an accurate measure, so I find this mode a bit difficult to use, especially because you don't have a preview. The other mode, by number of segments, will use the number of segments input and will add nodes so you get that amount of segments. Much more easy to use in my opinion, but still not as easy as adding nodes manually with the Add Nodes button in the tool controls of the Node tool. Approximate curves by straight lines is an interesting one. It will take a path with curves and it will transform those curves into a series of straight lines. With the flatness input, you can control how close the straight lines will follow the curves. Convert dashes to paths will convert a stroke with dashes applied to a series of strokes. This extension exists because when you transform a stroke with dashes to a path using path stroke to path, it will transform each individual dash into a closed path. This extension, on the other hand, will transform each dash into its own stroke, something that you cannot do in any other way in Inkscape. Envelope deformation will do the same thing than the envelope option in the perspective envelope path effect. You need two paths. One will be the envelope, and the other one will be the one to be distorted. That one needs to be on top and cannot be a built-in object. If you use one, you'll need to transform it to a path by going to Path, Object to Path. Also, you can use it with groups, which is nice. I wouldn't recommend you to use this extension. It does the same thing than perspective envelope, but with much less options and not in real time. Fractalize will roughen up the shape, creating multiple planes. Subdivisions handle how many planes will be created, and smoothness how smooth is going to be the change in planes. Inset Shadow is a bizarre extension that does something similar to what a filter would do. It creates a light and shadow area inside of the shape, making it look like a relief or a button. Internally, this extension uses a black shape and a white shape that follows the contour of the selected shape and that have a blur applied and are inside a clip. You can even break it apart after it's been applied. Illumination angle will change the angle of the light. Shades, how many sections of light and shadow there will be. To me, it starts to look bad after going past 3. You can also control the blur in other options, but that's best left to handle once it's been applied. This extension can save you some work if you want some quick and dirty light, but to me it looks horrible. I'd skip it and do it manually. Jitter Nodes will do just that. Slightly move the position of other nodes up and down to make the shape more wonky. This extension works best with a shape that has a ton of nodes. Don't forget that you can add nodes by using this button in the tool controls of the node tool. The only truly important option here are these two inputs, where you set the amount of displacement in the X and Y direction. You can also shift the handles for extra wonkiness. Perspective does the same thing than the perspective option in the perspective envelope path effect. Just like the envelope deformation extension, you'll need two paths, and the one that will be distorted needs to be on top. And just like with the envelope deformation extension, I see no reason to use this extension when you could use the perspective envelope path effect, so skip it. PixelSnap will snap your objects to the pixel grid. In Inkscape, like in most vector software, you don't usually work with the pixel grid, like in a raster software. That's why Inkscape won't show it and you can't interact with it. But if for some reason you need an object to snap into what it will be the pixel grid, maybe for when you're exporting a small object, then you can use this extension to do that. Proper Stretch is a really cool extension. It will stretch any object vertically as if it were made of rubber. You'll need a lot of nodes on the path for this extension to work nicely, so don't forget to add them with the Add Nodes button in the tool controls of the node tool. Strength will handle how much it will be pulled, and Curve, how much it will bend inwards. A really fun and interesting extension. Straighten Segments will straighten any segment between two nodes. Percent will control the strength. At 0% it is untouched, and at 100% it will be fully straight. Behavior changes the way the curves are straightened. You only have two options and they don't make much of a difference. I got no idea what toAbsolute does. I've searched online and the only thing I could find is that apparently Inkscape stores the position of the objects as either absolute or relative, and I think this has something to do with that. Maybe useful at the moment of opening an SVG file in a browser. In any case, I couldn't find what it does. Sometimes it moves the position of an object in a group far away, and sometimes it doesn't. Maybe someone can illuminate us in the comments. Twirl will twirl the selected objects. Like with many of these distortion extensions, you'll want the object to have a ton of nodes to look the best possible way. Amount of twirl will control the strength. The bigger the number, the more turns it will make. And if rotation is clockwise is checked, the twirl will be done clockwise. Otherwise, it will be counterclockwise. And that was it for now. Next video will cover even more extensions. For now, don't forget to like and subscribe, and let me know what you thought of the video in the comments. And have fun playing with these extensions. Bye.